Ty Dillon releases a podcast episode titled I Quit Today, and the Superstar Racing Experience reveals their first race car, and it's intriguing. How's it going, y'all? My name is Eric, and welcome to Out of the Groove. Out of the Groove is sponsored by Fram. We have a couple big news stories left over from yesterday that I want to hit on this morning. There's a lot going on this week. My video schedule is going to be a little bit wonky, so bear with me, y'all, but we have a lot to discuss from yesterday. A couple very interesting and very polar opposite stories. We're going to start with the Ty Dillon story, because Ty Dillon opened up and got very personal in a 15-minute YouTube video he posted to his channel yesterday. That's right, fellow YouTuber Ty Dillon, you might say. We'll look at photos and analyze the Superstar Racing Experience race car at the end of the show, but let's go ahead and start with Ty Dillon. Quick backstory on Ty Dillon so we're all caught up. Ty Dillon, of course, spent the last 4 years racing full-time in the NASCAR Cup Series for Germain Racing. That team shut down at the end of last season because Geico backed out from being their primary sponsor, so Ty Dillon went into the 2021 season without a full-time ride. He picked up a few races for Joe Gibbs Racing in the Xfinity Series. He also made a start in the Busch Clash for 2311 Racing. Technically, Ty Dillon will be the first driver going down in history to race for Michael Jordan 2311 Racing, but his 2021 schedule is far from a sure thing. His future NASCAR career is far from a sure thing, and after these first few weeks have not gone according to plan, of course, he ran well in his Daytona dual race when he attempted to qualify for the Daytona 500, but he did not make the show due to a technicality in the rule book. Because of where the other open cars finished in his dual race, they've reverted back to Wednesday afternoon qualifying speeds, and his Gaunt Brothers Racing entry was not as fast as some of the other cars he was going up against, so based on that technicality, he did not qualify for the Daytona 500. He followed it up by crashing out of the Daytona Xfinity Series race. They had, I guess you could say, a mechanical issue at Homestead, Miami a couple weeks ago, and then Las Vegas this weekend. He spun out once by himself, just got loose, and then later on, his spotter's radio apparently went dead on a restart. Ty Dillon moved up in front of somebody, did not realize he was out there. That set off a wreck, so he's tore up a couple race cars this year. He has not had any good finishes to his credit thus far. It's been a difficult season for Ty Dillon, and going back to the end of 2020 with Germain Racing shutting down, it's been a very difficult and very uncertain several months, at least now, for Ty Dillon, the grandson of Richard Childress. So today, well, yesterday actually, Ty Dillon released a 15-minute podcast video to his YouTube channel. I'll play a couple clips for you, but I definitely encourage you to go check out the entire thing. We're going to talk about some of the highlights. He titled this video, I Quit Today.
I think, you know, traveling home late after the race Saturday night and then Sunday, being at home and having to watch another cup race at home on TV is not easy when you are, you feel like you are mentally and physically should be in the race there. And all this may sound like whining and complaining, but this is just my life, and I want to transfer it straight to those who care or are interested. And it's all within good perspective of I'm very blessed to get to drive race cars. This has been my career, but this has also been my whole life. And just like anybody else, when you've worked really hard for something, it's taken many years of your life to get somewhere, a lot of time and effort. You want to see it through. You want to see it to what your end goal was. I'm just in a place where I feel like at the end of last year, I'm the best I've ever been mentally and physically as a race car driver. And as soon as I started getting close to that point, the opportunities have dwindled and become few and far between.
Throughout this piece, Ty Dillon continuously reiterates the importance of letting your emotions out and being willing to accept help from others before you can move forward with your life. He gets very deep. He talks about a heartfelt, emotional conversation he had with his wife yesterday morning, shortly before, I guess, he turned on the camera or the microphone and began recording this piece. This whole video really provides, you know, the viewers, the audiences, you and me, a truly honest and enlightening view into the mental side of being, I mean, let's be honest, a struggling race car driver, a driver who currently is at the low point of his racing career. He talks about how important it is to him as a young adult. How old is he? 28, I believe? Wanting to provide for his wife and two kids, you know, long term. He's still a very young guy. He's got his whole life ahead of him, and he still has a lot of questions that need to be answered. It's not often you hear someone who competes or has recently competed at the top level of whatever sport they participate in get this real, you know, be this honest. And especially be honest about the negative side of things. You know, we all sometimes take a step back and say, you know, how hard can these guys really have it? I mean, even if they wreck out or aren't running well, you know, they still get to race, drive race cars for a living. They're all making good money for the most part. You know, what right do they have to honestly complain? But there's a whole mental side behind this sport. There's a mental side to everything that is often difficult to illustrate. It's difficult to put into words and show people. But that's what makes this 15-minute video very impactful, because you get that deep look into, you know, the dark side of motorsports, of being a professional athlete. When things aren't going well, you feel like your entire world is spiraling around you. And you really, that really comes through here from Ty Dillon. I don't mean to like just analyze this like I'm some sort of, you know, psychiatrist. I'm certainly not. You know, I want to focus on Ty Dillon, the person, as well. You know, he talks about how he's still working hard. You know, while he titled the video, "I Quit Today," he has not actually quit. He even talks about how he's going to go racing again here. His next race is a few weeks from now at Bristol Dirt, apparently. So he ends this on an optimistic note. I don't mean to sound like I'm, you know, just overanalyzing Ty Dillon and not worrying about the person who's actually saying it. Like, no, I want what's best for Ty Dillon. You know, I'd say I've maybe been hard on Ty Dillon, the driver, recently, but I also think I've been very, very fair. Personally, I don't want anything bad for Ty Dillon. I hope he finds what he's looking for. I hope he succeeds in whatever he sets out to do, whether that be driving race cars. I'd love to see him get some great results for Joe Gibbs or forever, whoever else he drives for this year. I'm rooting for Ty Dillon. I want to make that perfectly clear, but I just can't help but note how interesting it is to hear an athlete very near the top of his profession really getting honest about the difficulties, the mental difficulties that, you know, athletes go through when things on the track, on the field, are not going well. But he goes on and talks a little bit more. He talks about how he's going to keep working hard, but he's not entirely sure if it's ultimately going to pan out for him in NASCAR. So I'll play that clip.
I can't sit here and say, you know, I'm not a motivational speaker in the sense of it's all going to work out and, you know, you work harder than anybody and everything's going to work out. I don't know if it's going to work out, but I do know I want to live my life with positivity and hope. Encourage.
Again, the whole video is more than 15 minutes long. I encourage you to go check it out, whether or not you're a Ty Dillon fan. You know, he also reiterates multiple times that he's not looking for sympathy. He's not looking for someone to come along and listen to this and then fix all of his problems. Like, he doesn't want to come across as ungrateful or anything like that. He sounds very aware of, you know, the opportunities he has had, and he sounds very thankful for them. And that's actually one thing I can give Ty Dillon a lot of credit for, or at least respect, you know. Up until this point in his career, he has driven in some way, shape, or form for his grandfather, Richard Childress. I mean, even though Germain Racing was not an RCR team, they were an RCR-affiliated team, so I'm sure there were some connections there. I give Ty Dillon some respect for really recently, especially, trying to make it on his own. You know, he drove trucks, he drove Xfinity, and sort of association drove Cup for his grandfather, but right now he's trying to tough it out on his own, find his own funding, find his own deals, and I truly, truly respect that. You know, will Ty Dillon make it in NASCAR as a driver? I mean, only time will tell. Again, like I said earlier, I feel like I've been kind of hard on Ty Dillon this year, but I do think I've been very fair. If we just look at the numbers, Ty Dillon, you know, spent 2 years in trucks driving full-time for RCR. We're talking 8 or 9 years ago now, but he did win 3 races across those 2 seasons, and he finished 2nd in the points behind Matt Crafton in 2013. That's pretty good. He got promoted to Xfinity. He spent roughly 3 full-time seasons in Xfinity, again driving for RCR, top-level equipment. He only won 1 race, but he was very consistent, had 24, 25, top 10s a season. That's really, really consistent. Even for the Xfinity Series, finished 5th, 3rd, and 5th in the points those 3 seasons. So not winning a whole lot, but certainly being consistent. Of course, he got into the Cup Series. He spent 4 full-time seasons racing for Germain Racing, a mid-pack. You know, that's a C-tier team, not a competitive team. He managed to win a couple stages that people like to talk about and point to as some of the highlights of his Cup Series career. He's got a couple top 5s to his credit, a few top 10s. No wins, of course, but in that equipment, nobody is expecting him to win. You know, he's a good race car driver. In fact, I was looking up his stats. He won 7 times in 2011 in ARCA. 7 out of 19 races. As a teenager still, he won. That's pretty substantial. I gotta say, that's noteworthy. So he's done some winning. That's more than I can say for some of the other guys racing in the Cup Series today in, you know, somewhat okay cars. Analyzing Ty Dillon as a race car driver specifically, he's fine. He is serviceable without a doubt. He's not going to tear up equipment too often. he's good. He's fine. I don't know that he's ever going to graduate to that next level and become, you know, a contender in the Cup Series. Even if you put him in great equipment, you know, he'll be a top 10 guy. I don't know that he's going to find victory. And he'll be like an Eric Almirola. I feel like at this point, the best we can hope for from Ty Dillon is Eric Almirola, a guy who will make the playoffs in good equipment, but doesn't win hardly ever. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's perfectly fine. I'm not trying to badmouth Ty Dillon. I'm just trying to be fair. I'm analyzing the results. One win in 3 years with RCR and Xfinity is, I mean, he's consistent, but you need to win more. I mean, Tyler Reddick won like, what, 6-7 times in that car basically a year ago, 2 years ago. I really respect Ty Dillon for putting that video, putting that piece out there yesterday and really opening himself up, being vulnerable, opening himself up to criticism because, you know, he's put himself in a very vulnerable situation, and there are people on social media, it's just the way we live, the world we live in, there are people that are going to pounce on that in a very negative way. So, you know, I respect Ty Dillon for putting himself out there the way he did, and I sympathize and empathize with a lot of the things he said in there, and I do think it's impactful. I bet there's a lot of people out there that find encouragement in the words that he published yesterday. But, you know, while I'm rooting for him personally, and I want him to succeed at what he sets out to do, you know, if I'm just being realistic, you know, race car driver Ty Dillon, I don't know what opportunities he's going to get from here on out. I hope the best for him, but I am being realistic. And it is really interesting to hear a driver going through a tough spot in his racing career be realistic and be honest with himself and with all of us as well. Anyway, I've harped on that enough. Go check it out if you have not heard it already. Certainly an interesting and an enlightening thing to hear from, you know, a driver near the top level of his profession. Anyway, I wanted to give that the attention I felt it deserved. Now, let's talk about the Superstar Racing Experience. You guys remember at this point, it's the series that Tony Stewart and Ray Evraham concocted this past offseason, set to debut in just a couple months this summer. The first race is June at Stafford Motor Speedway. The series will be broadcast on CBS. Apparently, it's the main CBS. That's pretty cool. Broadcast TV, primetime Saturday night. I'm excited for that, just that alone. Tony Stewart, Bobby Labonte, Bill Elliott, Helio Castroneves, Tony Kanaan, Paul Tracy, Ernie Francis Jr., Mark Webber, Willie T. Ribbs, Michael Waltrip, Marco Andretti, and I apologize if I missed anyone. I think I got all of them at least so far. All those guys will be competing in this series, six races, Saturday nights throughout this summer on CBS. That's pretty cool. But finally, at long last yesterday, the SRX revealed the race car, designed by Ray Evraham himself. Here it is, and would you take a look at this thing? Very similar to the renderings we saw a few months back, but a couple maybe subtle differences, most notably. I'm sure all of your eyes were immediately attracted to that wing on the back, very Superbird-esque. Not quite as tall, perhaps not quite as gaudy as the Superbird, or necessarily as the renderings we saw. The renderings made it look like it was gonna be super duper tall. I mean, it's substantial, it's notable, it's there, but it's maybe not quite as tall as they initially teased. Either way, first impressions, this car looks sleek. It looks a little bit different. Really, the wing is what sets it apart from anything else we see on track these days. But if I ignore the wing, first impressions, this kind of just looks like a late model car, like a stock car, like we'd see, you know, racing at many of the tracks that I guess they're going to be racing at this year. I mean, that's kind of what it looks like. It looks like a late model with a few unique accessories, perhaps. I mean, you got the vents, the hood vents on the front there that are interesting. No splitter. Notice there's no splitter on the car. Dale Earnhardt Jr., I saw, took notice. I mean, and the SRX is begging for Dale Jr. to join. We'll talk more about that in just a moment. But aside from the no splitter, the vent, you know, the wing, of course, I'm sorry, I keep going back to the wing. It's just there. It's big. You know, Ray Evraham said that it's really just for show. You know, they didn't want to put a spoiler on the back, anything that would have any major aero implications. I mean, the wing will play some factor. It'll have a role in this thing, but it's not going to be as intrusive, I think, as the spoiler. Goodyear tires, you may notice. Tony Stewart fans may be a bit surprised to see that, given Tony Stewart's history with that brand. Also, the grille. The grille opening is shaped like a chunky X. I like it. It's on theme for the SRX. That's kind of cool, assuming it's functionable. Another thing you can't see by looking at the car right here, but apparently the engines, as was reported a couple weeks back, will be supplied by Ilmor, the same folks that supplied the engines for the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series. These cars are expected to turn around 700 horsepower. That's more than what the NASCAR trucks pull at short tracks, but still a little bit less than what the Cup Series cars currently turn at short tracks on their schedule. I like this front view a lot. You know, it really shows you how low and wide this car is. I mean, it looks mean. I think it looks really, really good. I'm not really sure about the little hump there on the center of the hood. I mean, I guess it looks fine. I don't have any real complaints. Overall, this thing looks mean. I like the smooth sides, the smooth doors. Again, that kind of goes back to that late model, maybe NASCAR Gen 4 feel a little bit. Overall, I like it. I mean, it's, again, very similar to what the rendering showed us a few months back, but to see it in person, you know, finally, about 3 months before the series, you know, starts racing, this is exciting stuff. Really excited to see it. I want to talk about paint schemes a little bit because we still don't really know what the cars are actually going to be painted to look like. You know, kind of like IROC, at least the way I remember IROC, most all of the cars were basically a base white, but they had like some, you know, stripes and stuff on the side that were like red or purple or green or yellow, depending on the driver. So each driver kind of had their own color. I assume that's what they're going to do here for SRX, but, you know, I don't really want to see all the cars this base gray. I'd rather the base be, you know, whatever color the driver's getting. I'd like to see each driver for the most part. I know there's, what, 12 drivers, so you might run out of colors after a while, but I'd like to see every driver kind of get their own unique color, like Tony Stewart orange, Bobby Labonte green, Bill Elliott red, Michael Waltrip blue, that kind of thing. And then, you know, you can have the silver or gray or white, whatever you want it to be, on the sides. That can be that little design where it says SRX. But I'd like the base, the main color, to be something bright and colorful that stands out and it's easy immediately to identify your favorite driver on the track. Let me know what you guys think of the all-new SRX Superstar Racing Experience race cars. I think it looks pretty cool, but I'm really more care about how it's going to actually race. Short tracks will, I'm sure, lend themselves to great racing, but the car will play a role as well. So let me know what you guys think of the cosmetics, if you will, down in the comments. I do have to say, I'm excited for the Superstar Racing Experience, but as we get closer and closer to the opening night, the first race, you know, I find myself feeling a bit more and more skeptical that this thing is actually gonna work and become like an annual thing or a long-term success. You know, I have plenty of faith in Tony Stewart and Ray Everham, but, you know, while IROC and series like that in the past were cool because it featured current present-day superstars, you had the best drivers at the time still in their prime racing in that series, you know, this sort of just feels like a bunch of past their prime race car drivers trying to rekindle some of that magic. This feels like the plot of The Incredibles, you know? All these guys, Bill Elliott, Tony Stewart, Halo Kessler, they were superheroes in their prime, you know, when they were dominating, winning races in their respective series on a regular basis, winning championships. Now, this feels like in The Incredibles when, you know, Bob is like saving people from burning buildings just to feel something again, feel like a hero again. That's kind of what this feels like. They've just built their own playground to have some fun in. And, you know, I just don't know how many people are really going to tune into this stuff. You know, when you know that these are, sure, great drivers. And yes, I'd say some of them count as superstars. I'm not sure that they all fall in that same category. They're not all, you know, top tier A-list celebrities or anything like that. I won't go that far. They're big names. There's interest there. But you know that these guys are not in their prime. You know you're not watching the best drivers. You're not watching Tony Stewart at his best. You're not watching Bill Elliott at his best. You know, how much of that will affect the viewing experience at home? I'm not sure. Maybe not much at all. But I think there will be a little bit of that there. And so that's the only thing that concerns me. I'm not sure if fans will really latch onto this series the way Stewart and Everham are hoping. I think it helps that they're going to be broadcast on CBS primetime Saturday night during the summer. That's going to certainly get this series in front of some eyeballs, at least at first. So it might work, but as we get closer to the due date, to the opening night, I do feel myself feeling a bit more skeptical that this thing is going to really be a runaway success. We'll see. Time will tell. I don't want to sound like a naysayer. I'm just being realistic. I guess that's the story of this episode. I'm realistic today. Very, very rooted in realism. That's no fun. We got to get more fun and exciting in future episodes. Anyway, guys, thank you all for tuning in. Let me know what you guys think of those SRX cars, what you think the SRX series is going to look like here in just a few months. Let me know down in the comments. That's all I've got. Be sure to subscribe if you're new to the channel. We talk NASCAR almost every single day. I know today we talked about the SRX. Really, we talk about any motorsports with a NASCAR affiliation in there. Thank you, as always, to my amazing Patreon supporters as well. Could not do this show without your continued support. We'll be back later this week. There's always new things popping up in the world of NASCAR, so I'm sure we'll have a lot more to talk about this week before Phoenix this weekend. Looking forward to that one. Thanks for watching, y'all. Take care. I'll see you in the next video.